and welcome to the Masterclass Monday. I am Kathrine WINDFELD from Denmark, and I am the very thankful and lucky winner of this year's LetterOne Rising Stars Jazz Award 2019 European Edition. And LetterOne serves to discover new jazz talents and to help them make a career. And LetterOne has been endorsed by, for instance, Jamie Cullum and George Benson and other great stars. And the winner of LetterOne gets the opportunity to play at 7 major jazz festivals. So for instance, I'm looking very much forward to playing in Spain and Italy. But as you might know, I guess everything has changed due to the coronavirus. So now the whole industry is on pause, and children around the world can't go to school, and people have lost their jobs, and the whole music industry is totally, we don't know what to do, and musicians stay at home. So instead of inviting you out to concerts, we will come to you, and I hope this masterclass today can give you some inspiration and encourage you to keep playing or keep listening to music or staying inspired somehow. And not least, I will send my warmest thoughts to those of you who might have lost a family member or a dear friend to the coronavirus. So I hope this little session can bring some joy into your life and be a little escape from this crazy situation outside our windows. What you just saw was a little snapshot or a little teaser from my tune called ORCA, or the killer whale, and it was a tune I wrote last year. And today I want to describe how I write music and how I think when I create music. I write music for big band and also smaller groups, but my primary project is my own big band. And besides from that, I also tour with the other professional big bands. So I always have to be super creative when I write music, because I can't just write something very simple or unison, because there are always like 15 or 17 great musicians sitting in the band, and they are kind of hungry lions, so I have to find something to feed them with. And writing big band stuff is a very like symphonic discipline, but I think you can use my ideas also when you write for smaller groups. So I hope what I will show you today can be an inspiration for those of you who write music, or those of you who are just interested in knowing how you can put things and elements together to create a harmonic and rhythmic tension, for instance. So my focus will be on creating tension on a rhythmic level, on a melodic and on a harmonic level. So if we look at the first theme, I started out finding this idea. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And if you look at it, it's actually, you can say it's a G major triad on top of C. And it has a very light and bright sound. And then I thought I would try to move it upwards, so I said, so it's an A flat triad on top of C. So it's a kind of modulation, because here it's a kind of the, yeah, the first one could be a C major 7 with a 9 on top, and then you actually somehow modulate to A flat. And that change of color is very effectful, I think. And then I thought, how about moving it up one more step? So I got the A triad on top of C, and that's far more dissonant, but I really like this tension from, because we have this pedal point which keeps it all together somehow, but the change of color is on top of the bass note, and that's a very effective way of composing, I think. It's a very strong tool. And then I wanted to end it with something, so I said, so it has like a, it's in four parts. On this last chord, I tried to make a B flat minor 7, but I wanted to add something extra, so I put both septimas. So it has this very dissonant inside of it. So, and rhythmically, I have I thought it was not enough with 4-4, so I made it like 4-4 and then 7-8. So it says 1-2-3-4. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So there is a harmonic tension with the chords moving upwards, and there is a rhythmic tension because first I have this strong or heavy 4 beat. 1, 4. And then I switch from 4-4 to 7-8, so it's a very unstable feeling, and the tune is about the killer whale, so I wanted to create this tension and this feeling that you can make sure that you're safe. So when I had created the main theme, then I thought I would go backwards and make an intro as well, because it was maybe a little too much to start out with this main phrase. So I thought, how can I show the frame of this this figure? So I thought I took the some of the chords and put together and in a lower register. So instead of G major, I took just the root and the fifth and I put it down here. And then one more step. Instead of that, I took this sharp sound. I thought that was a nice way of starting the tune. So now that I had an intro and I had the main theme, I thought, all right, what's next? And instead of bringing in something new, I wanted to develop my main theme. And what could I do? I could put in some fills that should serve to confirm or question the harmonic content. So the first fill I made was so like a little unexpected twist. I put on the sharp 5. Instead of that was a little too jolly for my taste, so I like that one. And then we come to the A flat, and then the fill goes like. And for the third figure, I wanted to make a little more sophisticated fill that was not too melodic. And we have the A triad on top of C. So I made like a little chromatics and not too linear, not too melodic. And finally, some polychords, you can call them. It's these very nice sounding harmonies, and they consist of two triads that sound very familiar. So an F major and an G major. And in my right hand I have a D flat major and an E flat major. And they have some very nice internal dissonances. So these are not very common chords, but they I like the fact that they consist of two familiar things put together in another context. And finally, this one once again. So at this point, I thought I was not totally ready to move on to something completely different. I still wanted to somehow see if I could take the theme to a next level. So and try to build even more to make a climax. So I really like to stretch things and see how much I can get out of a small idea. So what I could do, I thought, was like, I had stuck to the pedal point for a very long time, so why not try to make some new harmonics to the theme? So I wanted to move away from that C pedal, so I tried some different colors, and I ended up with this. So it's moving very fast through a lot of colors, I think. So these are not dominants or anything, it's just changes of color. So it's not like functional harmonies where you have the dominant going to the tonic, but these are just the change of colors that make some great movements. And for the next one I make like... This is pretty dissonant. And with a large range with the registers. And the last one, so I ended up with this very nice A triad on top of an F. For the third part, I would like to develop these polychords even further and the upward movement, so I made like... And I ended up with this very nice sounding A flat on top of an A, making these three internal great dissonances. And when I write these concepts, I don't stick to a certain idea or a theory or something. I really try to use my ears, and of course I like systems and I like to put things in order somehow, but the main point is to make something that's interesting. And I think it's hard to just use music theory or a specific plan you have. You can. It's always nice to have some restrictions which can make you creative, but instead of sticking to that specific idea, you should open up and see how long it can take you. But if it doesn't bring you to a specific musical place, then you better just split up or do something about it. So it's about making music and using your ears, not necessarily some very strict systems. But let's listen to the tune from the beginning to this point. And I should say that at this last part of the theme, I also make some fills in the trumpets, but it's impossible to play everything on the piano. So let's take a look at the video.
Thank you. this point, I thought, now it's time for something new. Now I have twisted and turned this theme a lot of times, so now I think the listener is ready to listen to some new ideas. So I came up with a bass line that's kind of funky. And actually, when I rehearsed it with my band, some of them thought that it was in four, like one, two, three, four, dun, ga, go, go, ga, da, go, ga, go, go, ga, da, go, ga, go, go, ga, da, go, ga, go, go, ga. But it is in three. I hear it in three, like don't ga, 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 go, go, ga, da, 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 da. But I really like the fact that some of the band members were confused about what is this, what is the subdivision, and I mean, there is no correct result. I like the fact that it has these two possibilities, so you can hear it in two ways. And then I wrote a theme on top of the bass line, and that became a long process where I developed a little theme, like with the main theme, and I tried to twist it in many ways. And in the beginning, I stuck to the main key, which is like, this is the main tonal family, you can say, or the main scale. So I wrote like, so that was the main theme. And then I moved on and made a lot of variations of that. And I go more and more out of the key, so gradually I move away from this flavor. So it goes like, so gradually I start to use all 12 tones in the scale and not only the main scale. So that's a way of stretching the melodic content. And also rhythmically I make some twists where it suddenly, it becomes 4-4 in one bar. And also I add more and more instruments. After this long movement and a couple of solos, I return to the theme, but now in another context. This time I have ended up in 3-4, like this bass line, so I stay in the 3-4, and then I make an ascending bass line and make the theme more symphonic. So I try to make it as bright sounding and as a great release. So after this, we return to the theme again, so we don't need to listen to that right now. But I can skip to the very end of the tune. And in the end of my tunes, I always try to bring a little new thing, but it shouldn't be like groundbreaking new, because the listener is not ready to accept something completely different in the end, because then it's not an ending. But I like to merge different elements from the tune. So in this case, I actually merge the 4-4 bar plus the 7-8 that I used in the beginning of the tune and the funky bass line. So I tried to write the bass line instead of in 3, then I stretched it so it fitted with the 4-4 bar and a 7-8 bar. And it sounds like this. So one thing I really do appreciate about this ending is how the drummer and the guitar player are so creative. They are kind of, they have kind of free roles, because the bass player and I, we stick to the bass line, but I just told the drummer to be very like sophisticated and play upon the groove. So he could also have chosen to be very like punchy and really stating this bass line, but instead he picks some of the syncopations in a very delicate way, and the guitar player makes some distance and some remote sounds like an alien or something, so they really contribute to a great vibe here, and that's the most important thing, because of course when you look at the bass line with all the syncopations and stuff like that, and 4-4-7-8, it's very like mathematics, and it could be very cold and not that interesting musically, but I think these few free rolls there are in my music, they are so important, because it's very strictly written, lots of notes, and all the horn players have to play exactly what I have written, but the drums in general and the guitar player have more free roles in this tune. And in the beginning, the drums also play a lot of busy 16th notes to create this tension in the air and this feeling that the killer whale is lurking beneath the surface. And the same purpose, it's the same purpose with the piano fills, also very busy fills. I hope you got inspired by listening to how I create music, and I hope you got some new ideas maybe, or maybe you disagree to my methods. But at least I think it's very interesting to talk about creativity and how you put things together to create something new, because I have talked to several young, very young composers, and also many different composers and musicians, and many people try to think they have to be so original all the time. And I think it's very important to distinguish between originality and creativity, because of course we all somehow strive to be original, but it's very hard to judge your own work and to tell, am I original now? Do I write original music? So I think there's a danger bringing in that goal into your rehearsal room and say, I want to make something that's very original today, because in my opinion, it makes you avoid a lot of things, because you write a little thing, you play a little part of something, and you say, oh, that's not original, or that's not sophisticated enough. But if you ask me, I think the great composer knows how to develop a little thing. It's not the first little sequence that's the interesting point. The interesting point is your ability to develop musical elements. So originality, I mean, it's nice if people think you are original, but you can't tell yourself, you can't evaluate your own work, because who of us have listened to all music in the world? You know, of course you can try not to be mainstream and not to be too predictable, but
I mean, I haven't listened to everything that exists. I don't know if there are lots of big band composers who have made exactly what I do or something. So I, in the beginning, I also thought, wow, I have to be so so exclusive and so like a first mover or something. But I have left those thoughts because it just makes me it brings me too heavy expectations somehow. So, but the creativity, if you think I have to be creative, I want to be creative, then you see the music from inside. You kind of develop the things on the musical level without concentrating on your surroundings that much. So try to really go deeply into the material and try to hear what does this phrase want me to do. Then I think it used to go in the right direction. So it's just a small advice to be, so also not to be too hard on yourself and to put too much of a pressure on your shoulders. So, because if you think, wow, today I'm going to make something totally next level and original, then there is a huge danger that you don't write anything because you are too hard on, so you just judge everything you make and think, oh, I have heard that before, that's not good enough. So it's much better to write a lot, and then after a while you can take the good parts of it and you can throw the rest away. It's not the, yeah, it has no consequences to write a lot of stuff and then throw some of it away and keep some of it. It's just creativity, and it should be playful in some way. Finally, I have to say that you can actually donate to a charity, the great organization Doctors Without Borders, and they do a fantastic job during the coronavirus situation. So under this video there is a button you can press to donate. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope you got inspired, and I hope to see you in real life. Have a nice evening.